Penguin Random House Canada presents Halfbreed by Maria Campbell, read for you by the author.
Introduction. The house where I grew up is tumbled down and overgrown with brush. The pine tree beside the east window is dried and withered. Only the poplar trees and the slough behind the house are unchanged. There is a family of beavers still there, busy working and chattering just as on that morning 17 years ago when I said goodbye to my father and left home. The graveyard down the hill is a tangle of wild roses, tiger lilies, and thistles. The crosses are falling down and gophers scurry back and forth over the sunken graves. The old Roman Catholic church still needs repainting, but because of the poverty of the congregation, it continues to wait another year. The blacksmith shop and cheese factory across the road have long since been torn down, and only an old black steam engine and forgotten horseshoes mark the place where they once stood. The store is still there, old and lonely, looking like the country around it, and like the people it serves merely exists. The French owners who came from Quebec are dead, and their families have gone. It's as if they were never there. Granny Campbell's house is gone. The half-breed families who squatted on the road allowance have moved to nearby towns where welfare handouts and booze are handier, or else deeper into the bush as an escape from reality. The old people who were so much a part of my childhood have all died. Going home after so long a time, I thought that I might find again the happiness and beauty I had known as a child. But as I walked down the rough dirt road and poked through the broken old buildings and thought back over the years, I realized that I could never find that here. Like me, the land had changed, my people were gone, and if I was to know peace, I would have to search within myself. That is when I decided to write about my life. I'm not very old, so perhaps someday when I too am a granny, I will write more. I write this for all of you, to tell you what it's like to be a half-breed woman in our country. I want to tell you about the joys and sorrows, the oppressing poverty, the frustrations and the dreams. Chapter 1. In the 1860s, Saskatchewan was part of what was then called the Northwest Territories and was a land free of towns, barbed wire fences, and farmhouses. The half-breeds came here from Ontario and Manitoba to escape the prejudice and hate that comes with the opening of a new land. The fear of the half-breeds that their rights would not be respected by the Canadian government when it acquired the land from the Hudson Bay Company, along with the prejudice of the white Protestant settlers, led to the Red River Rebellion of 1869. Louis Riel established a provisional government at Fort Garry, Manitoba, but escaped to the United States in 1870 when troops arrived from eastern Canada. So with their leaders and their lands gone, the half-breeds fled to the areas south of Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, and established the settlements of Duck Lake, Batoche, Saint-Louis, and Saint-Laurent. There was no government in Saskatchewan at the time and no law and order, so they formed their own, fashioned after their way of life, the order and discipline of the great buffalo hunts. They elected Gabriel Dumont as their president, and with him 8 counselors. They set up laws by which the people could live peaceably, and penalties if the laws were broken. They made it clear that they weren't opposed to the Canadian government and would abandon their council as soon as the territories acquired a true government and was able to establish law and order. Here for a very few years they lived happily, but the 1870s and 1880s brought the settlers and the railroad, and just as it happened in Ontario and Manitoba, their way of life was again threatened. They were squatters with no title to the land they lived on. They wanted assurance from Ottawa of their right to keep the land before the incoming white settlers encroached on them by using homestead laws. Our people believed the Lands Act discriminated against them, stating they had to live on the land and wait 3 years before filing a claim. They had lived on the land for years before the Lands Act had even been thought of, and didn't believe they should be treated like newcomers. They sent many petitions and resolutions to Ottawa, but again, as in Ontario and Manitoba, Ottawa was not interested and continued to ignore their existence. Finally, in 1884, they decided to ask the only man who could help them. Gabriel Dumont and three of his counselors rode to Montana to see Louis Riel, who lived in exile. Riel returned with them to Saskatchewan to discover that it was not only half-breeds who had reasons to complain, but white settlers and Indians as well. Because of pressing demands in the East, MacDonald's conservative government had cut federal monies going to the territories. This left the Indians without the rations and farming assistance promised to them under the treaties. The white settlers had suffered one disaster after another, including 3 years of drought. This, together with their dissatisfaction over the Land Claims Act, had completely soured them against the federal government. This time, petitions and resolutions went to Ottawa from white settlers, half-breeds, and Indians. Again, Ottawa ignored them. The half-breeds by now were angry and ready to take up arms, but Riel and the white settlers didn't want a rebellion. Riel believed there had to be a more peaceful way to make Ottawa realize the urgency of their requests. Dumont, however, had no faith in the federal government. He believed only an armed rebellion would give them what they asked for. He urged Riel to seize Fort Carleton and to declare a provisional government as he had done at Fort Garry in Manitoba. Finally, Riel took Dumas' advice and established a provisional government. He gave the Northwest Mounted Police at the fort an ultimatum, to surrender or they would attack. Meanwhile, Dumas had gathered together a party of armed half-breeds and Indians and without Riel's knowledge approached the fort. Crozier, the Northwest Mounted Police officer in charge of the fort, had sent to Regina for reinforcements when he received Riel's ultimatum. However, on seeing Dumont and his party approaching, Crozier decided very foolishly to take his inexperienced troops out against Dumont's skilled sharpshooters. This was the Battle of Duck Lake, a victory for the half-breeds, and was the beginning of the Riel Rebellion. The majority of white settlers didn't want violence and withdrew their support after Duck Lake. But the treaty Indians, who were starving because of Ottawa's broken promises, supported Dumont and Riel. Poundmaker and Big Bear, chiefs renowned as warriors and respected throughout the territories, brought their warriors to join forces with the half-breeds. After Duck Lake, Ottawa hastily formed a committee to examine half-breed grievances and issued land scripts to assure the half-breeds of their land claims. But these were issued purposely to a chosen few, which caused a split within the half-breed ranks. Had the committee been formed earlier, the Battle of Duck Lake and the Riel Rebellion would never have happened. Meanwhile, Eastern troops under General Middleton were being sent to Saskatchewan. The CPR line had not been completed, and troops and supplies had to be transported on sleighs between unfinished points. Within a month, 8,000 troops, 500 Northwest Mounted Police and white volunteers from throughout the territories, plus a Gatling gun, arrived to stop Riel, Dumont, and 150 half-breeds. The history books say that the half-breeds were defeated at Batoche in 1884. Louis Riel was hanged in November of 1885, charge high treason. Gabriel Dumont and a handful of men escaped to Montana. Poundmaker and Big Bear surrendered, were charged with treason and sentenced to jail for 3 years. The other half-breeds escaped to the empty pockets of northern Saskatchewan. The total cost to the federal government to stop the rebellion was $5 million. Chapter 2. My people fled to Spring River, which is 50 miles northwest of Prince Albert. Footnote: names of persons and places have been changed in some cases. half-breed families with names like Chartres, Isbister, Campbell, Arcan, and Vandal came here after the Riel Rebellion, where the men had been actively involved. Riel was gone now, and so were their hopes. This new land was covered with small lakes, rocky hills, and dense bush.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.